Tonight, Sir Richard is going to give us a talk on the decline of the West. You know, Richard knows it. You know, Richard.
Thank you very much, David. And basically the structure of this talk will be to, first of all, to discuss the evidence for the decline of the West, then move on to the possible causes, and then some solutions, and also the implications for libertarianism as well. Of course, this phenomenon, the decline of the West, is actually welcomed by some people, like the Greens, for example. They love a bit of stagnation and steady state growth and nothing much going on. And it's actually a deliberate policy of theirs to try and choke off wealth creation and to redistribute resources to different parts of the world. So, you know, some people are quite happy about this phenomenon. As far as the evidence goes, it's clear that there has been a dramatic relative decline in the West position. So if we look back at around 1900, according to the estimates, Western Europe, for example, accounted for about 35% of global GDP. And by 2020, that's likely to have fallen to around 12%. So it's been a huge shift. In around 2014-15, China overtook the US as the largest economy when it's measured by GDP adjusted for purchasing power parities, which is a better measure than crude GDP, which is affected by currency fluctuations. So, you know, on probably the best measure, China's now the world's largest economy. And probably India will move to number two in around 15 to 20 years' time based on current trends, you know, 6-7% growth a year versus probably 1-2% in the US. But that's relative decline. There are also a lot of people worried about a absolute stagnation. So there are some, we've got to be careful about using some of these statistics because obviously, you know, there are question marks over GDP figures and wage measurements, etc., etc. But you know, there are some quite worrying statistics that you can take or leave. So, for example, you know, median wages in the US have been pretty stagnant for the last 40 years. A lot of European countries, it's a similar story. So, in Italy, for example, living standards are probably no better now than they were in the late 1990s. Even in the UK, it's done relatively well in the sort of longer term. Last 20, 30 years, there's been little real wage growth since the early 2000s. And it's also quite worrying, there's also been a stagnation in productivity growth as well, which is probably what would explain the stagnation of wage growth partly. It's possible that this is just a bad patch, partly due to the financial crisis, but you know, quite a lot of this stuff predates the financial crisis. And there's also been, you know, worryingly slow recovery, and you know, one idea is that this, to some extent, the you know, printing money and the explosion of debt was a sort of central bank's or elite response to this stagnation that was going on, a sort of a short-term political response to try and kick the can down the road. Now, this has been all pretty pessimistic, but I want to add an even more pessimistic note now. A lot of people don't really realise this, but a lot of Western economies are, a lot of the economic activity is based on what we might term neo-imperialism, so various forms of sort of protection rackets and writing the rules of the game in favour of the West. There are quite a few obvious examples, but I saw a study recently that was looking at how in Britain's ex-colonies, British companies still dominated the natural resource sector. I mean, one of the worst examples is the way the UK propped up the Nigerian federal government during the Biafran War that resulted in a couple of million people starving. And of course, you know, BP and Shell then got the oil contract in Nigeria for massive amounts of oil. But eventually, you know, I think these sort of neo-imperialist relationships will crack just because of a function of GDP. you can't really divorce, for example, military spending from GDP. So as non-Western countries grow more quickly, after a bit of a lag time, you know, I think a lot of this protection racket stuff will shift elsewhere, particularly because if you look at the US, for example, it's sort of imports and exports are a relatively small part of the economy. It's got quite, you know, massive natural resources of its own, so the incentives for it to continue to get involved. Obviously, you know, one of the biggest rackets is the protection of these kleptocracies in the Persian Gulf, like Bahrain, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, etc., UAE, with a lot of the money that's being made is then pumped into Western financial markets, and also massive amounts of contracts going to Western businesses. And I can see all that stuff gradually disappearing as the centre of economic gravity moves east. Because I just don't think the incentives are there for the US to carry on spending all these huge amounts of money. And they won't be able to compete as their GDP declines in relative terms with other powers, some of these rising powers who have a much bigger incentive to get involved in those areas. So you could see sort of a compound effect at some point where a lot of these rigged rules, these rackets, if you like, disappear as well, is the other problem. So your sort of rentier state type sources of wealth. So moving on to some of the postulated causes, and unfortunately here we're left with many, many different theories to explain the decline or relative decline or stagnation of the West. These phenomena sort of interact with one another, so they're not so clear cut, and often they're quite difficult to measure as well, which makes it even more difficult. What I would say is that there are some basics of economic geography at work here, kind of thing popularized by Paul Krugman. Now, I'm not a big fan of his generally, but he kind of has a point here. If you go on Wikipedia or Google or something and look at a map of the world according to population density, it's clear there are probably three natural causes to the global economy.
Krugman,
K-R-U-G-M-A-N. And he won the Nobel Prize for this sort of this new economic geography as well a few years back. So there are three natural causes of the global economy based on concentrations of population, which are Western Europe, the sort of East China Plain, and the Indo-Gangetic Plain, which is sort of running from Bangladesh through India to northeast Pakistan. And so the point is, obviously, the biggest of those natural causes probably, it's a toss-up between the Indo-Gangetic Plain and Eastern China, probably with a bias towards the Eastern China, because it's got a lot of other big countries nearby, like Japan and so on. But the point is that as soon as they adopted relatively sensible policies in China, which they did in the late 1970s when Deng Xiaoping adopted a Chinese version of Lenin's new economic policy. There's an idea that, you know, the Chinese model was free market, and whenever I hear that, I tear my hair out, because it was, okay, they allowed some, you know, modest property rights and so on, but it isn't a free market success story. It was their version of Lenin's new economic policy that Lenin introduced, I think, in 1921, when, you know, pure communism had caused famines and it was a complete disaster. So he allowed some forms of property ownership, and small and medium-sized businesses were allowed as well. But the big stuff was kept under state control, which is pretty much as is the case in China even to this day. And that doesn't make such a massive difference, because the real problem is, as they found in Venezuela, when you try and micromanage, the state tries to micromanage stuff like food distribution, the small scale, medium scale stuff. But the larger businesses have they have severe economic calculation problems anyway. So the difference between having it in national, you know, state ownership or privately owned is smaller than with a small, medium size, sort of naturally medium-sized parts of the economy or small business parts. But as soon as they adopted relatively sensible economic policies, then because of this natural advantage they had with the economic geography, they could enjoy enormous economies of scale and agglomeration economies. Now, obviously, it means that, you know, they can have a single steelworks producing more steel than the whole of the UK does. They can have 40,000 ton trains compared to the 2,000 ton trains we have in this country. The ports can be huge. Now, the agglomeration economies, that's something similar but slightly different. That's a clustering of businesses in a small geographical area. So if you're trying to create the next electronic gadget or the next fashion line, you've got all the subcontractor suppliers all in close proximity. So it's very easy to do. You can also bounce ideas and compete with your competitors all in the same place. This is thought to massively increase potential productivity, essentially. So you've got these two factors. So, in southern China, you've got the Pearl River Basin, where you've got Hong Kong, Shenzhen and Canton, these massive cities, all probably 200 million people, all in a very small space, with just huge, huge advantages compared to other countries. It's kind of almost like, it's a little bit like a sort of economic black hole, in the sense these core areas will sort of drag economic activity into them naturally, in the sense of, they just have such huge advantages. Of course, we haven't seen India really take off in the same way, but that's in some ways, in terms of those agglomeration economies, it's got even more potential, because you've got 1/7 of the world's population in an area the size of Turkey. So the possibilities there are absolutely enormous. But obviously, they adopted a lot of the British policies dating back from the 1940s, from when they gained independence, and they're still very hamstrung by that, and huge amounts of corruption and so on. And nonetheless, they're still achieving good growth. I mean, the problem is, a lot of this stuff's all to do with state intervention and, the Chinese building, railways and roads and riding roughshod over private property. But it's been a success in terms of crude GDP terms, and they have become a massive economy and probably the world's largest. Now, at the same time, how do you explain the West's relative decline? Because as I mentioned before, Europe also is potentially one of the natural cores of the global economy. On pure economic geography, probably number three in terms of potential, and also obviously had a head start and so on. So it should have done pretty well, but it's got a major problems at the moment. Now, the first of those is a demography. So it's got a rapidly aging population. This is likely to slow growth due to a higher burden on health, social care spending, and the rest of it, pension spending. And add that to democracy as well. So the average active voter in the UK apparently now is 53 years old. So they're not exactly going to vote against higher pensions. And you see that in the so-called austerity period, that was the one thing that was untouchable. So pensions got the triple lock, whereas there are very harsh cuts for some working age benefits. So there's a big difference there, but that is explained by the crude electoral calculation, when pensioners do actually go and turn out and vote, so did a lot of late middle-aged people as well. Obviously that sort of puts a question mark over democracy itself, where people can sort of vote themselves resources from other groups of people. Is that a fatal flaw of the West? And that's another big question. I mean, has China benefited from the kind of stability that the Communist Party has provided with its new economic policy that they've allowed to run, and huge amounts of political stability over the last 40 years or so? I mean, just a caveat there is that think about how awful it was before then, though, under Maoism. So you could say that could easily flip to something terrible again, potentially. But I think it's unlikely now. They've sort of built some quite you know, powerful special interests who believe in their sort of model of state capitalism and benefiting from their model of state capitalism. Now, another question mark, some people are saying, you know, they talk about, I think it was Keith Joseph that got into trouble for this, the human stock issue. And some people say that the West's declining because, an increasing part of the population has got problems from the poor having a very high reproduction rate compared with the rich. But I think that's probably exaggerated because of, you know, factors like regression to the mean. It's one of those issues, you know, no one really looks at, to be honest, but there has been a shift since the 1960s towards, you've kind of got a sort of bulge at the top end in terms of the income distribution of births and a bigger bulge at the bottom end and sort of a gap in the middle, which is probably likely to lead to more social polarisation, all things being equal, that you might say would have some sort of effect on the West performance. But once again, it's kind of a don't go there issue, so there's not much research on that kind of thing. What I would say though is, you know, there is the problem with cultural change in the sense of a high time preference. So that's the idea of instant gratification. I think that is a problem that's been fostered by the welfare state in the sense that, you know, people are very present oriented, living hand to mouth, and that will tend to reduce the savings rate, to reduce investment, and also put more strain on the welfare state as well, because as people, you know, take it's more a moral hazard thing, you know, irresponsible behaviour is kind of bailed out into the welfare state. So that would tend to, if you like, rot the culture, arguably, in certain ways. Immigration is another controversial issue that some people say is a problem for the West. One aspect of it is that immigrants from the third world do tend to vote for the more sort of big government party. So I think 70% of sort of new Commonwealth migrants in the UK vote for Labour. So it does affect the sort of political culture. In the US, I think 1 in 10 white Americans consider themselves broadly libertarian. It was done in a way that sort of revealed their political preferences rather than the direct questionnaire, are you a libertarian? Whereas it was only 1 in 100 Hispanic, so there's a big difference in the political culture there. But that could change over generations, so it's difficult to tell. I think all we can say is, you know, we just don't know what the impact of immigration is going to be on culture or the economy in the long term. I mean, I don't think, you know, these people who look at the last 10 years and say, you know, their employment rates are this, that, or the other, I think that's kind of, I mean, it doesn't really deal with the longer term issues either way. But obviously, we know that, you know, potential benefits in terms of matching skills to jobs and so on. So, you know, difficult to tell with that one. I mean, I think a prime source of the rot is what we might term crony capitalism. So one commentator of this was the public choice theorist Mansur Olson, who wrote The Logic of Collective Action and the Rise and Decline of Nations. And the logic of collective action is pretty simple theory, and that's the idea that it looks at economic incentives, and obviously a concentrated special interest like a particular industry like the steel industry or farmers have much stronger incentives to lobby for government favours like subsidies or regulations than the general population. So general taxpayers, consumers, they're a dispersed group with very poor incentives to lobby the government for favours. So you basically get exploited by these concentrated special interests because of this disparity in the incentive structure.
Could you give me that name as well?
Mansur Olson, so MANCUROLSON. And logic.
Mansur Olson.
Yeah. So you find the Logic of Collective Action and the Rise and Decline of Nations. Yeah, so Olson thought that because of this tendency, if you had a period of relative stability, you know, absent wars and complete disasters, that these groups of special interest would grow and coalesce over time. He called them distributional coalitions, but you can see it's a, a form of crony capitalism. Now, I'll give you an example on an area I've done research on, which is the privatised rail industry. So this is a classic distributional coalition. So it relies on government subsidies, around 5 billion direct subsidies a year, and it lobbies for more subsidies, and also it relies on big increases in network rail debt, which is public sector. It also lobbies for to try and strangle the competition, so to stop road building and to keep the weight of lorries restricted, and you know, that sort of thing. To lobbies for planning control, planning policies that concentrate new development around railway stations. So they've got a sort of captive market, you know, and those new developments where no one's allowed to have a car, those sort of things. It lobbies for all this stuff. So that's a very simple example of a distributional coalition. That's one of the minor ones. I mean, some of the really big scams are things like the banking and finance system. You know, they rely on these huge bailouts, on quantitative easing, huge amounts of money being printed, you know, the fractional reserve system, backed up by the state. Also, loads of tax breaks to encourage, you know, the pensions industry. And if you look at, you know, the financial industry is also, a lot of it's based on this neo-imperialism, this rentier state sort of stuff that I mentioned earlier. You know, a lot of the city gains its economies of scale from some of these long-term scams that are based on conquest and state aggression. Yeah, another one's the planning sort of NIMBY banking conservationist network as well, that pushes up the cost of housing. You know, loads of bureaucracies in the local councils benefiting from that. I mean, you know, I know some people from Africa and are astounded that they, you move to this country and actually have worse housing here than they did in Africa. But there's, you know, these countries that have a GDP per head of, you know, about a tenth of the UK's, because they're actually allowed to build build what they want, more or less, on the land there. It doesn't actually cost that much to build, you know, a bungalow, breeze blocks and so on. The actual building materials cost very little. A huge amount of it's to do with the planning. It's the planning controls and building regulations. It's an absolutely enormous scam. So, and there are also all these protected professions, like, you know, accountants, lawyers, all the rest of it, who completely rely on, sorry if anyone's one of those people, but this is just a general statement and not direct to anyone in particular, but there are huge numbers of these people. They're often the really terrible thing about it is they're often some of the brightest and best people in the West, wasting their time completely in terms of sort of wider economy, just in these jobs that are entirely dependent on government regulations and are fundamentally utterly useless. And so, you know, just these vast swathes of people, and then, you know, the management consultants and all these civil servants and, you know, all these people basically doing unproductive work. Also, these vested interests, these crony capitalists, these distributional coalitions, they're also a massive barrier to innovation and reform. So if you think about some of these sectors like health and education, you know, the huge potential for efficiency gains and productivity improvements. Think about with education, you know, often I think the education system actually hinders people. Actually keeps them down and stops them learning anything. And, you know, a lot of sort of self-tuition, particularly with new technology, you know, is very low cost, very efficient. But all this is, you know, it's for decades now, it's all been blocked by the teaching profession and by the local councils and all these special interests who rely on all this regulation and government spending, you know, to keep themselves in careers and jobs and so on. Yeah, with health, you've got the medical profession, the GMC protecting the number of, restricting the number of doctors and requiring very stringent licensing regulations. But increasingly with new technologies, a lot of that stuff isn't necessary. They're just basically doing what the computer tells them or following a strict path. But, you know, they'd be just as good if they only had 1 year's training rather than 7 years or whatever they have now. In a lot of cases, not for every single job they do, but nonetheless, there's a massive amount of protectionism going on there. So, you know, I think these are all possible causes of the decline of the West. Now, I think solutions are actually quite difficult to come up with, partly because obviously these sort of big tides of demography and economic geography are quite difficult to reverse. So when, you know, Trump talks about protectionism, I think there's sort of a bit of a King Canute sort of aspect to this, trying to stop the tide coming in, because fundamentally the US is a peripheral country. It's not part of this, you know, Eurasian landmass. I think it was the founder of geopolitics, Halford Mackinder, who first pointed this out. But as soon as you had quite efficient land transport, then his idea was that the heartland of the world was the Eurasian continent, and if anyone could link these core areas together, then this was going to be, you know, a hugely powerful economic bloc. And of course, that's been a cornerstone of US policy for years now, to try and stop that happening. So particularly, you know, to make sure Germany and Russia don't get on and control Central Asia as well, like Afghanistan and so on, stop these core regions coming together. Because it does basically put the US is basically kind of in a similar situation as South America. It's naturally a peripheral part of the world, and it had a bit of a lucky break when it had a combination of fairly liberal policies, and then Europe was tearing itself apart. We always forget this was no free market paradise as well. It was an era when they were genociding the Native Americans and had a massive state-sponsored land grab in the late 19th century and afterwards. So, but nonetheless, some of the sort of ideas I hear to reverse the decline of the West are things like pro-natalist policies. They're trying to increase the birth rate to address at least the demographic issues with that. I think it's actually quite hard to do in practice. Now, in Russia, they managed to increase the fertility rate quite a bit. Up to, I think they got it from just over 1 to around 1.6, 1.7 now, which still isn't the replacement rate, which is about 2.1. But they had a sort of specific problem with a sort of an abortion culture that they've managed to address with things like, you know, offering free counselling and sort of that kind of thing. But I think pro-natalist policies are actually quite difficult to achieve in a relatively free society. So I suppose you could offer big welfare payments for children, but the danger is that you'd end up with a sort of bad distribution of the births then as well, which would cause quite a lot of problems. You know, people doing it just to get welfare payments. So I suppose you could do address some of these interventions that are probably sort of anti-family formation, like the planning system that I mentioned before, and the fact that I think a lot of people delay having a family because they can't get decent housing. So particularly in that sort of middle ground where the birth rate's particularly low, you know, you could have win-win policies that might help a bit, but it's difficult to know how these policies would actually work in practice, whether they'd actually be effective. But yeah, I think if they're sort of win-win either way, it would make sense. Now, if you think immigration is a problem, and I don't think we really know at this stage how it's going to pan out, I think the answer there would be to move to a libertarian system where you would have voluntary communities decide who is allowed in. So you would then have a market discovery process, which would tend to sort of filter out a lot of the problems, I think, and maximise the benefits. But I think the chances of that happening are basically zero. If it's, you know, illegal and freedom of association / dissociation is completely illegal in all Western countries now. It's even illegal under EU law. So, you know, you're kind of forced to follow a particular policy there. So that's not, I suppose it could change, but I think it's unlikely in the foreseeable future. Now tackling the sort of crony capitalism distributional issue, distributional coalition issue, I think that's very difficult as well. And we've seen that a bit with Brexit. So, there's a possibility of having for example, unilateral free trade, so having no tariffs on incoming goods. I think Hong Kong and Singapore have that policy. New Zealand adopted it in something similar in the 1980s. And the idea is to focus on the benefits for consumers and also the benefits in terms of it means that your businesses will have to be sort of competitive on world markets. So they sort of have to adjust to reality. You don't get the sort of East German problem producing Trabants that are these cars that are sort of 40 years out of date, because you, if you don't compete with the best in the world, you're going to get out of business. But, you know, that's not going to happen because the farmers are going to scream blue murder saying, you know, we'll have to abandon the uplands, the sheep will have to go, and you know, the steel industry will say, oh, well, we need steel to build battleships, you know, to keep the country safe. So, you know, and the car industry will go berserk as well. That's heavily protected by mostly by non-tariff barriers that prevent competition from places like India. So in India, for example, they produce a car called the Tata Nano that sells for about less than £2,000 brand new in India. But to bring it to the European Union and sell it in the UK, they'd have to sell it for about £7,000 or £8,000 to meet all the regulations. So there's a huge amount of hidden protectionism there. So I mean, all these groups are going to go berserk. So I think tackling the crony capital issue is going to be very hard. But I mean, there are examples though of determined politicians tackling special interests. So the classic one was what Thatcher did to the miners. Now I don't approve of the methods that she used, and I think the Conservatives went far too far in terms of favouring other forms of management. Nonetheless, it shows that some of these distributional coalitions can be smashed, given enough determination. But the worrying thing is she went for the mines, she didn't go for the lawyers, for example, that are even a sort of problem on an order of magnitude bigger than the miners were in terms of, you know, leeching off society. So that's the worrying thing. So all this is very difficult, difficult politically, potentially. But I think it does present a lot of opportunities for libertarians, because as things do start to crack up and Western economies do stagnate, then, you know, we as libertarians have actually a kind of off-the-shelf set of policies that could be adopted. But the problem then is getting them past all these special interests and distributional coalitions who are going to resist any policy. So it's like in the 1980s, you know, with all these fantastic ideas about privatising stuff, but then, you know, the privatisation programmes just became basically captured by the crony capitalists, because the problem is the actual process of privatisation itself is going to be affected by these incentive structures and nobbled by the special interests. So it's got to the stage now where, some of these privatised industries are so inefficient that it'd probably be better if they went back into government ownership. And I hate to say that, but for example, the energy industry, all it does is it allows the politicians to blame these greedy companies for their stupid green policies that push the price of electricity. Whereas if it was still nationalised, they never would have been able to get away with it, because they would have been a direct blame on the politicians for those daft policies. And, you know, the railways, another one that hasn't worked out too well because of these transaction costs. Yeah, I mean, to be fair, the water companies, they... I mean, on the plus side, they do at least have some incentives to keep costs under control, but at the same time, they have incentives to overinvest in infrastructure because they're allowed a percentage on the capitalist profit. So yeah, it hasn't worked out too well, because it's naive to think that somehow privatisation as a political process will be immune to these incentive structures. So, you know, it's almost like a J-shaped curve like that. So, you have sort of a nationalised industry that then if you go, you actually get less efficient when you go to these hugely heavily regulated dog's breakfast privatisations, because you've got all these transaction costs. Suddenly you've got companies with a huge incentive to lobby for more and more subsidies, which you didn't really have in the nationalised sector. You've got to push it further towards the free market to get the real efficiency gains, get get out of this heavy regulation and get some proper entrepreneurship and innovation, some real incentives for that kind of thing. So, but there are, I think that nonetheless, there are opportunities for libertarians, and we have to learn from the mistakes that were made in the 1980s when, you know, we did have some kind of influence over at least, you know, sort of a powerful minority of politicians. But I mean, also there's a danger that obviously people in the movement itself will sell out as well, as happened before. So, because you know, the think tanks and so on influencing policy, they do heavily rely on donations. So the problem is that particularly sort of more left-leaning libertarianism, left libertarianism is probably the worst in terms of trying to get donations, but. Yeah, right libertarianism can sometimes get money from things like the tobacco industry, providing they're happy with intellectual property and that kind of thing, which I'm not. But the problem is that you know, neoliberals creating these fake markets, you know, education vouchers, for example, that are heavily controlled by the government, this then creates sort of a crony capitalist feeding ground. So those are the kind of policies that will tend to get the money. So in a sense, the libertarian movement itself can be corrupted, sell out by these incentive structures as well. So that's a big danger. So it might seem like we've got the solutions, but then the people actually giving those solutions to the politicians, the intermediaries, could quite easily sell out for their own self-interest. I mean, it's happened time and time again. And just look at how ineffectual the Beltway libertarian think tanks have been in America, despite the huge amounts of money that have been pumped in. And yeah, most of them have completely sold out, and it hasn't worked either. They haven't achieved much at all. The other dangers are that there's a tendency towards protectionism. Sort of, I don't think Trump's going to go very far with that, because I think he's, you know, there are checks and balances. But if protectionism was done in the wrong way, it could have pretty bad consequences. Not that what we have now is free trade; it's heavily regulated trade, but nonetheless, it doesn't mean to say things couldn't get worse, as we saw in the 1930s to some extent. And I think another issue, though, is, you know, will the US decide to maybe starting off with protections, but then actually go for a military reaction to losing its hegemony? And that's a big danger. So already we see that it's surrounded China's eastern seaboard with bases to try and control the South China Sea and so on. So it's got bases in South Korea, Japan, the Philippines, Guam, and so on, and, you know, various puppet governments further south as well. So that's pretty dangerous, and that also explains why Russia's now so powerful, because as long as Russia and China are allies, then China can't be starved out by the US, because Russia can supply its energy and food needs. So that partly explains some of the current shenanigans in geopolitics. I think, you know, there's a bigger problem. If the sort of there is this shift to the East, then I don't think libertarian or free market ideas are very strong in those countries. So all things being equal, you know, I think that could be quite worrying for the movement, which I think at the moment at least is kind of embedded in the US and UK and Anglo-Saxon, so-called Anglo-Saxon countries, are not very strong elsewhere. So all things being equal, as other countries become more dominant in the East, it's going to weaken the libertarian movement. And there's not much sign of any sort of evolution of libertarian ideas in some of these countries like China. I mean, it's a bit like Europe. There are a few sort of so-called free market sort of organisations, but they're very much on the sort of more neoliberal side rather than full libertarianism and, you know, sort of another form of state capitalism, essentially. So that's quite worrying. So, you know, I think this has been a pretty depressing talk. So I think probably the only advice I can give to end this with is to probably, you know, sort of give up and emigrate and make the most of it, I think. Thank you very much. I'll end it there.
Thank you. Thank you. Is there any questions or criticism?
Any great to wear?
I'd recommend Burma, actually. I think that's got a huge potential, as the potential link between China and India. They're obviously, the big powers are going to be competing over it, but That'll mean loads of money gets poured in.
So you said earlier, freedom of association is virtually illegal. What do you mean by that? Are we freely associating here?
Well, it means that if you wanted to set up your own proprietary community that restricted entry to certain people, like if you look at the Troy Southgate and the National Anarchist Movement, a libertarian group, they want to sort of separate themselves off into small communities to try and preserve their culture, but that's not allowed under the current law. So that's the example. But what I see is a discovery process, and you would have sort of cosmopolitan places competing with sort of conservative places, and the market would play things out and probably get a decent balance or patchwork of communities.
This chap here.
Observation and a question, both partially negative and a little bit of positive in there. The observation is, yes, absolutely, the West has declined in sort of relative terms, but I think a lot of other places have kind of stuffed as well. I don't really believe more GDP figures out of China. Productivity is fairly dreadful. They've got major sort of demographic problem with the one child policy, and local people have dropped dead due to pollution. Japan stagnated for 30 years and India's never quite lived up to expectations, and Brazil has just entered 20 years of austerity due to corruption. So there's perhaps some degree of positive in that dreadful dreadfulness. But the question is, as I kind of wonder whether the West might need to move to libertarianism as a sort of reluctant response to how stuffed it is. In that we're seeing sort of debt to GDP ratios incredibly high. We're seeing sort of various levels of demographics drop out, drop away, which I think is largely due to overtaxation and population density. Whether you think we might get to a point where the money runs out, which means they have to cut back on the state.
Yeah, I think what we find is that the governments will move back to that point on the Laffer curve that's revenue maximising roughly. So that would be, in the UK, would be the government spending around 40% of GDP, which is roughly where it's heading now. So they really struggle to raise much more than that in taxation for various reasons, because, you know, sort of it, when you squash it down, it sort of pops up somewhere else. You know, there are various feedback mechanisms. But I don't think it will go much lower than that because of these vested interests in the ageing population. But you can probably keep things ticking over at that sort of level. And I suppose the issue is if you get even worse growth rates and you have sort of pretty much close to zero sort of gear stagnation, I think that partly depends on what's going to happen to technology. This is a debate that I didn't really mention, which I was meant to actually, but there's some debate as to whether there has been a slowdown in the rate of innovation, and you don't have these big groundbreaking innovations that increase productivity, things like the railways and you know, the chemical industry that we had in the 19th and early 20th century, and then the motorways in the 60s and so on. We might have a few like good, nice electronic trinkets, but there are none of these sort of truly groundbreaking innovations, and so there is a rate of slowdown there, productivity growth. Law of diminishing returns. So if that's the case, then I suppose they could do that. And also, I suppose the geopolitical issue of not wanting to, you know, become sort of second fiddle to China might encourage them to move towards trying to optimise growth rather than optimising revenue. So it's a possibility. You're right about China, though. It has got its own problems. So I suspect it will sort of could easily get caught in the middle income trap. But even if it's GDP per head, adjusted for purchasing power parity, is about $20,000 per capita sort of figure, it's still going to be by far the largest economy in the world. And the point is, the other point about defence spending, because I've had rows with people about this, that a lot of people don't adjust it for purchasing power parity. So the US now spends $600 billion a year on defence, and China spends about $150 billion. But the point is, on the purchasing power parities index, the US is 1 and China is about, say, 0.4. But that means it gets probably gets 2.5 times more stuff for its defense spending per dollar than the US does. And the same applies to Russia as well. So already, you know, the combined China and Russia aren't too far off the US levels defending in terms of the amount of actual capability they can pay for with that money, because the costs are much cheaper there.
What is the Middle East contract?
Can you wait until after? Mm.
How do you feel about emerging technologies and future technologies going to affect this? Because the West, we do still have a relative advantage, technologically speaking, comparison to China, India, Russia, particularly in the military sphere. We do still have a large technical advantage. The Russians often look scary, but a lot of the equipment is not necessarily as good as they may claim, and there's often not available data to show just how good it is. Even the Chinese, they're still learning. The new Chinese carrier, even though it looks scary, it's being operational, when our new carrier comes into service, it will still be nearly 5 times as powerful capability-wise because of our ability and our experience in using that type of technology.
Yeah, I think you're right, but I think that there's a lag time, isn't there, between, if you like, the size of the economy and the strength of the military. Like with, you know, the Royal Navy, even during World War II, was, you know, the dominant force in terms of naval capability. But at the same time, the UK was no longer the largest economy in the world. So there is going to be a lag, you know, probably 20 years or so before China would overtake the US in terms of military capability. Now, they would say, I think the Russians are probably number one in terms of their missile technology in some ways. And look, the problem is, this is another classic distributional coalition, the so-called military-industrial complex in the States. You know, this taking up 4% of GDP or whatever it is, but it has been more. The whole system's so corrupt with, you know, former officials then joining these big defense companies. And they, unfortunately, it's all about a gravy train and feeding out of the trough instead of actually producing decent kits. And so you've got that F-35 that's, what was it, $400 billion it's cost, and it got beaten by the F-16s in a combat testing. So, but I'm saying a lot of the stuff that, and the aircraft carriers are just going to be a sitting duck, you know, against any serious enemy, even against Iran, probably, with the missiles.
I suppose it depends if you believe that actually going to fire this missile. We put a lot of our technology into intelligence systems, and you can sit one of our ships off the coast and gather a lot of intel. That's very useful in peacetime as well as wartime, but a missile's only really of use in war.
Yeah, I mean, that's the point that the aircraft carriers, they're very useful for attacking third world countries that have, you know, rebelling against the empire, aren't they? They're not much use against any serious enemy in an actual war. They'll probably have to withdraw them, like, you know, 500 miles off the coast, because they're just sitting ducks otherwise. I think I agree that, you know, the technology thing is the point. But, you know, I think technology diffuses very quickly to other countries now, though. You know, it's not the sort of advantage it used to be. It just quickly can get copied and taken up by other countries. So obviously military is a bit different because it can be kept secret, but a lot of the other stuff that's, you know, of practical use will quickly be adopted. So I don't see technology as being sort of Western technology as being the sort of source of some great obsession, because within a matter of weeks it'll just be copied, and probably copied more quickly because they don't have the same, you know, sort of planning regulations, etc. in these countries.
Do you still want to?
No, I just said, what is the Middle East income?
Yeah, it's kind of, it's kind of places like Brazil that have, you know, people have been saying it's going to, you know, become a developed country for years, but it's kind of got up to a certain level. It's not, you know, probably poor country, it's got up to a certain level.
So it lose impetus.
Yeah, and lost impetus and stagnated. But I think with South America, it's partly because it's, you've got geographical disadvantages, it's not, you know, a core region, so you can't capture these economies of scale. And also, you know, a lot of these countries have just had really, you know, really bad policies as well. And, you know, sort of the crony capitalism's, you know, even worse in some of these countries than it is in the West.
Feeding from the trough.
Well, that's what it is, yeah.
Yes.
Now,
do you think there's any use to building counter-institutions or kind of shadow governance organisations to counter this decline of the West, or is it saying that it's too easily co-optable and capturable?
Yeah, I think it's really important to try and do that. It creates a sort of safety valve in terms of freedom, a sort of exit route, and that helps to keep the big government and crony capitalism in check in the wider economy. So that would actually be my favourite libertarian strategy, because I think trying to create entryist movements into political parties and trying to persuade politicians, it hasn't worked, because the incentives for them to sell out are just too strong. We keep hearing about the great new libertarian hope, and then give it 10 years time and they always sell out, don't they? I think those counterintuitions also there are some of these stateless societies that still exist overseas as well, to really try and lobby hard against foreign aid and all these military intervention that destroy some of these stateless societies that are an important safety valve.
Anyone else? Pat?
Yeah, I'll just ask about what do you think about religions and these other quasi-political ideas, like, for example, so-called feminism, just for example, as a threat to libertarianism? Because you never did mention anything about that.
Actually, that's an interesting choice, because there is one theory that kind of... in terms of the demographics, feminism has been quite damaging by reducing the birth rate in Western countries, particularly among professional women. It doesn't mean to say it's wrong per se, but there could be some negative aspects of it. I think generally the cultural Marxism thing isn't helpful, particularly how it tries to clamp down on freedom of speech and freedom of ideas and political freedom, because I think it's very important to have a frank discussion about these problems, and also to experiment with new ideas. But universities now, it'll get shut down, and I think this is just another example of the kind of thing that leads to stagnation.
Yeah, I mean, for example, in the United States, it's just a simple example. I think the Catholicism and Protestantism has been a big barrier to libertarianism in a massive way, and it's never ever discussed anyway.
I wouldn't quite agree with you entirely, because I think religion has also been sort of a barrier to big government in other ways as well. For example, in communist countries, somewhere like Poland, the Catholic Church was a big sort of resistance to the spread of communism. So I think it works both ways. I think, beyond a certain point, it is a barrier to libertarianism, because Catholic social teaching is more in tune with ordo-liberalism, at its most free market, the most free markets of elements of Catholic social teaching, rather than full-blown libertarianism. So I think you're right at that scale. But at the other end of the scale, I think religion acts as a barrier to some of the worst excesses of big government.
Anyone else?
That's it. I have no question.
Oh, right. Paul.
Yeah, if libertarianism is the solution, given the West is by an order of magnitude much more libertarian than the East, why is it declining?
Do you think that's true? Because I'm thinking about things like...
Do you know?
Well, I think a lot of it's talk rather than reality. So, people will think about things like freedom of speech, but forget about, how the waste disposal has been regulated by the European Commission. There's a tendency to focus on particular areas and not other areas that in economic terms might be more damaging. So if you look at just the percentage of... national income spent by the government, then it's much lower in China than it is in the West now. So it's about 25% in China and about 40% or more in most Western countries. Also in terms of things like, if someone wants to build something and do something quickly, see, an entrepreneur, it's much easier in places like China than it is in the in the West. Okay, you might have to bribe someone there, but you still, at least you can get it done right here, because the Greens say no. Council for the Protection of Rural England says no, can't build anything anywhere. So
you can't even bribe them.
Exactly, you can't even bribe them. Yeah. So,
but conversely, you can't expropriate people quite so expeditiously either.
No, it takes.
Property rights are just taken more seriously in the West than they are in China.
They do kind of take them fairly seriously in China. Like, we've seen a picture of the some of those roads that have gone round the tower blocks. and that railway that actually goes through the middle of the tower blocks, so they didn't have to demolish it. you're right. I mean, I think a lot of it, I mean, the other issue is, you know, catch-up growth. And I think, once these countries have to start, rather than just grabbing technology off the shelf from the West, actually have to start inventing things once they've hit a certain level of development, it becomes much more difficult in these more controlled societies. So I think, you know, they are more controlled in certain ways and not in others, but it's difficult to measure those up. And obviously, people like ourselves will particularly value, you know, political freedom that we have in the West vis-a-vis those countries. So.
Yeah, you did mention freedom of speech, and you were rightly concerned that, Jermaine Greer has trouble speaking on campuses in the West, but I think this is slightly minimal compared to the repression of free speech in China,
yep,
or Russia or even India or some places like that. So there are problems with freedom of speech, but, you know, the right of, you know, trans exclusionary radical feminists to go around speaking at Goldsmiths College seems to be somewhat less important than the massive speech codes in a lot of the Eastern countries.
But is it really that different? I mean, if you were an Islamic Islamic fundamentalist, yeah, in this country, then you're probably going to be banged up for your beliefs. Or was that guy with the hook was sent to life imprisonment, deported in life imprisonment in America for speaking his beliefs?
Oh,
so God. I don't really see it. I mean, okay, it's a matter of degree, but the principle's the same. We also have massive internet censorship here now, just like the great firewall of China. So Twitter took off, 125,000 accounts last year, I think, for because they were dissident voices that weren't allowed, and
YouTube's under attack today.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, I agree. It's just a matter of degree, really. And
it's a matter of degree, yes. But people might moan that you get kicked off Twitter for saying politically incorrect things in the West. Turkey bans it. So, it's a degree, but it's an important...
Oh, yeah, no, I agree.
Bob always says, it's a matter of degree between a warm bath and being boiled to death.
Does the decline of the West mean that others have to rise or can all go down? I think there's mainly a rise in economic power in certain areas. I don't see them going to becoming a fantastically great society.
Is having a fantastically great society or even economic power a libertarian goal at all?
Well, exactly. I mean, we can start to question some of these assumptions, yeah. And I think, a libertarian society could potentially be quite poor because you could have, this is just theoretical, but you could have lots of very different types of communities coexisting, but because they were so different, you wouldn't have economies of scale, for example, or these agglomeration economies. You also have people like, deep Greens having their own communities that were very anti-growth, or some very conservative ethnic groups like the Amish in America, who wanted to live their own way. So we can't assume that a libertarian society would necessarily have high growth rates. I mean, it could do if people decided they wanted to move in that direction, but it could very well be quite static and conservative in at least part of this sort of libertarian archipelago.
Yes, if we're talking about the decline of the West, we've got to compare it to the West at its pop, which I suppose is the British Empire at its maximum extent. Now, marvellous though that was in many ways, all of its policy decisions weren't necessarily informed by libertarianism.
No, quite butchering the natives, for example. Exactly, that's what I mean. I mean, maybe the decline of the West is a good thing in many ways.
Pat, then.
Yeah, just to dwell very quickly on the last two points, what you were saying about being libertarian, being poor, When you mentioned about 1 in 100 Hispanics were pro-libertarian, but 1 in 10 Americans were, I mean, I was surprised at that because I mean, a lot of libertarians think that Mexico is more libertarian than the United States by a long shot. That's just
a fair point.
On the second point, just about what Paul mentioned earlier about overlooking important points in libertarianism. I think, I mean, for example, the elections in Holland, the Freedom Party, I did see a lot of this stuff on the TV, and no one ever mentioned that Geert Wilders for the Freedom Party had to be travel around in an armoured car and a small and a group of armed men to stop him speaking. Otherwise, he'll end up as one of the long line of free Dutch politicians who've been assassinated by religious fanatics. You know, I mean, it is.
Have there been that many? I know.
Oh yeah.
Pinfortuna or whatever.
Yeah, and you know, I would argue. I mean, well, from my point of view, anyway, that Holland is one of the very few what you could call libertarian areas in the world.
Really?
Their politicians, yeah. And when their politicians have got to travel around in armed cars, with you know, with the army protecting them, I mean, that is a wake-up call. But the point I was making is that that was never mentioned at all in the mass media by anybody, even in the Russian press, on the other.
No, I didn't realise that. Yeah. So, but you know, I don't think Wilders and his party, you know, were particularly pro-freedom, though. You see, they're very anti.
Well,
anti.
That's the name of the party.
Yeah, no, but they're very, very anti-free speech and wanting to censor this, that, and the other. And for example,
what can you say under
their?
What are you not allowed to say?
No, if you wanted to promote Islam in various ways, they were against that. So, but I don't think Holland is some sort of libertarian utopia. I mean, government spending is very high there, and they have all kinds of very heavy regulation and restrictions on free speech, etc.
Yeah. Wilders isn't against promoting Islam. He's quite actually wants Islam to be here. Actually, probably enough, quite the opposite.
Well, we can discuss this later. But I think he is pro censorship in many ways.
Just a sort of gut reaction. Whenever I hear talk about growth, now by any standards, historical standards, this is a rich society. There's never any talk about what we can do with what we've got already. There's never, it's always business models of what growth is increasing the economy. There's never, you know, what we could do which would improve humanity. For instance, my other main interest is artificial intelligence. Mm. And I think the singularity is near, and in my view, we're across the event horizon already. We could dramatically change human nature, you know, human society. And that to me is important.
Yeah, I mean, that's the great unknown, isn't it? To what extent we could have a raft of new innovations that could then increase productivity.
But there's so many societies on this. We're already, by historical standards, we got immense wealth already with the resources and know-how we've got access to.
Yeah, I mean, there's also...
We could not only change society, yeah, we could change reality.
But, I mean, obviously, like, you know, resources obviously aren't allocated efficiently at the moment.
No,
you know,
for real. Yeah.
You know, there's a huge amount, as I mentioned in the talk, huge amount of waste and vast amounts
of resources.
It's like
a prime objective of every politician to grow the economy. That's not necessarily the most important thing. We just used efficiently what we've got already.
Yeah, I mean, the
we use efficiently what we've got already to beat growth. We used efficiently what we've got already to beat growth.
Why? I mean,
yes.
That's...
No, I take your point, entirely. Yes. Yes, no, I totally agree. Yeah. But so much of growth of the economy is about people working longer and longer hours. You know, I love that phrase. I don't like Tony Parsons as a writer, but he said, you know, I grew up in the 60s. 1969, we got a man on the moon today. Tomorrow, we're not going to, you know, have to work at all. And that was a real aspiration.
And it was 100 years earlier.
Yeah.
I mean, Marx, for example, started thinking about the automated economy of abundance.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's an old dream.
Yeah, well, that's
no,
about
no, that. It was all doable.
Yeah, but
it's
that,
always
you're right.
It's not doable. I mean, one of the big things that people make about robots is they think robots will replace employment. Sadly, that's not the case.
Probably not, but they certainly could. Yeah.
No, I don't think that, unless people got unless people cooperated with them by, but then again, how would they get paid? You see, I mean, the benefit of robots is that they boost the output and therefore boost the average wage.
Mm.
But that means that people have to get jobs in order to get that. So therefore, no matter how many robots you introduce, robots just boost the average wage and make way for more workers.
Well, they boost inequality is the problem.
Is that a bad problem?
Contribute more to the media.
This chap here.
If you go back to sort of 50s, 60s, and think that we can develop technology to the state that we don't need to work anymore, they probably were right if we wanted to maintain our living standards in the 1940s, 50s. In that you probably could work just one day a week, but you wouldn't have half the technology, foreign holidays, and all the sort of luxuries of pretty first living. It's more sort of changing the level of expectations of what we want out of society that's carried on going.
But I think that's part of it, but I think it's also that huge amounts of people just doing completely pointless jobs now. You know, in these distributional coalitions that are just being created, these jobs created by regulation that don't actually add to wealth creation at all. I think that's part of, I mean, the state has actually expanded enormously since the 1960s, both in crude terms of, percentage of GDP spent by the government and the huge amount of heavy regulation that's followed since then.
Paul?
Yeah, a lot of people think they're working hard. Most of them, as you're right, are wasting their time. The only people actually working hard, to any point, is entrepreneurs behaving honestly. So not con artists, and not people in government sinecures or all the peripheries of that, which there are, but genuine entrepreneurs taking real risks, analysing the market and working honestly. They're the people who are working hard and they're the ones achieving. We need more of that and a lot less of the other.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of people working hard in India, especially the peasant part of India. The more backward society is, the harder you have to work.
I don't think that's true, David. If you look at the evidence on hunter-gatherer societies, they worked a lot less than.
But that's many, many. I'm talking about today, backward societies today, in the last 300 years.
You're quite right, if you
go back to the Redskins or in America or so, and they probably did have it. Anyhow, I'm doing too much talking here. Shall we all go for a drink now?
Yes.
It was terrific, honestly.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.